Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Change on the Run podcast, where we discuss common change challenges and ways we can address them when we're short of time. I'm your host, Phil Buckley. Today's topic is communicating effectively. Communication is the most important form of support people receive when going through work transition. It's also one of the biggest enablers of successful change because it aligns everyone on what is changing, why it's necessary, how it will affect them, and what they must do to adopt it. When done well, the results are brilliant. When done poorly, it leads to unclear messaging, incorrect perceptions, and disenfranchised employees. So, how do we communicate effectively to multiple stakeholder groups as they transition to new ways of working? My guest today is Linda Kennyhertz. Linda, welcome to the show.
Well, hi, Phil.
So great to see you again, and thanks so much for being here. Linda is the Managing Director of Strategic Change Associates, a leadership coaching, communications, and change management firm. Throughout her career, Linda has worked in global publishing, consulting, consumer packaged goods, and financial services and telecom. She holds an MA in Corporate and Organizational Communications from Fairleigh Dickinson University, a BA in French from Rutgers University, and a BA in English and Music from the College of New Jersey. So Linda, what have been your different types of experience in change communication?
Well, Phil, I've had a number of experiences corporately. Some have worked fabulously, and sometimes things don't go quite as planned.
I think we've all been there. Absolutely. So what makes good communication as people are going through change?
I've found that alignment at the senior sponsor level of what the goal is for the change is crucial to communicating that change to people so they understand what they need to do to be successful.
What happens when the leaders aren't completely aligned? Because I think you've seen, and I've seen a few times where leaders say that they're aligned because that's sort of the direction moving forward of the organization, and leaders need to hold that true and support it, but they're not necessarily as aligned as you'd hope they would be. What happens there?
When there isn't the alignment that you expect, you find that people start to renege on the communication they said they would sign off on. And what you really want to have happen is that senior leaders will confer, the project team will provide input, and the messaging will come from the highest level, the CEO, the project management team, and the supervisors, because I have found that employees really want to hear from only two sources. They want to hear from the top level, the CEO, and their immediate supervisor.
Is there a difference between the messages they want to hear from the senior leader and their immediate supervisor?
The words may be slightly different, but the essence of the message must absolutely be the same. People want to know that if I heard it from my CEO, I'm going to hear the exact same thing from my supervisor, so that I have confidence that everybody's aligned. And if I do what the messaging says, I'm on the right track. There was a recent article on climate change by Vox journalist Daniel Wallace Wells. He cited a paper published by Daniel Pauly on the topic of shifting baseline syndrome. And when I was reading that, I thought, oh my God, this is exactly what happens with employees. When you tell someone, we're going in this direction, get in line and follow me. Next week, we get a different message. Oh, well, we've changed our minds and we're going this way. Or worse yet, you don't get a second message. And you suddenly see that your supervisor is managing you in a different direction than the original message. People become confused. And a number of things happen when you don't have consistent messaging. When you believe the baseline keeps shifting, people start to pull back. They decide, I am not going to do anything because it seems that our leadership doesn't know what they're doing. And if they don't know what they're doing, then I certainly can't tell them. And you have, when people keep shifting the message or not sending a message, they don't understand that they are sending a message. And that message is, we don't know what we're doing. And therefore, we're not doing anything. So everybody sort of stops in their tracks. And the change that was supposed to happen doesn't happen. And this creates business failure, which puts people in jeopardy. And it makes everyone nervous. It makes people say, is my role in jeopardy? What do I do now? Nobody seems to know what the future is going to be. And we find that people start to shut down.
What do they or don't they do in that safe mode of I'm not going to do anything?
There are various behaviors that start to show themselves. In the employee body, you can see increased absence. You can see people withdrawing, not saying things in meetings that they would normally say, lack of interaction. And you can also see aggressive behavior, people becoming angry in situations that normally wouldn't occur. So you can see that folks are confused, and that confusion can show itself in various forms.
And then when that's going on, let's say you're leading communication or you're coming in for a rescue, because often I find initiatives that kick off that aren't successful, then there's a rescue point. You know, this is going nowhere. It's not going in the direction. We've missed our timelines, for example. We're not seeing where we want to go. Let's say you come in as part of the rescue team. People are doing very little, or if whatever they're doing is probably not as productive as you need it to be. How do you rescue something that's going into a downward spiral because of inconsistencies with leadership?
Phil, I can describe a situation in which this absolutely happened. As you know, many times on a change project, we as communication people on change or managing the change are invited in after the fact. It's sort of like it's off the rails. What can you do to fix it? Well, in one situation, I was brought in, and the first thing I usually do is I want to meet with the senior sponsor of the change, and I want to meet with senior leadership so that I can determine where they are, how they're moving forward, and what the game plan is, and so that I can decide, do I need to have some coaching sessions with people to figure out how to create alignment? Or are they all aligned and we're going to be sailing forward? In this one instance, I met with the senior VP of customer service, and there had been some changes prior to when I was brought in, some smaller changes. And so I thought, well, the way I'm going to start is to ask, how did you handle the communication on this prior small change so that I could get an idea of how are we going to move forward? Because you want to create and help this senior leader create communications that express what the change is, how people will be impacted, what their actions are. And you need to know the voice of the leader so that everything sounds cohesive. And I met with him and I asked, so what have you communicated previously about the change so that we can remain consistent going forward? And he said to me, well, I didn't communicate the change and I'm not going to communicate it now. I sat there and I thought, oh God, what am I going to do with this? So I said, oh, well, that approach is one way you could go. And let's talk about how it went and how we might either incorporate that approach going forward or make some adjustments. And he was quite adamant that he did not want to communicate about the change. It will just upset people. I said, well, I'll create a plan and we can go over it and see how we might help prepare people for what's going to happen so that they will be more willing to go along with the changes than they might otherwise. Now, let me say that this change did include downsizing. It did include major disruption. It included a plan to have remote teams and offshore teams. So there was a lot to help people understand about what was coming. And it was an uphill battle. I absolutely had to write every message for him. I had to create a plan for meeting with teams across the country and the globe so that he could deliver the message personally, because people want to hear from the leader. And I had to create a plan for line managers so that they could deliver the same message to their people. I can tell you that it was as successful as could be hoped for under the circumstances. Did I have to travel with this executive to every site and be there on hand in case he got into trouble when he was on the stage, which very well could happen because people were angry? You know, what do you mean I'm losing my job? It's your fault I'm losing my job. And I thought, you know, he might take the bait. And he did on occasion. And it was a disaster. So creating a plan to help people do things that they may not be aligned with is tricky. However, if you can help that person understand why it's important that they get behind the change and create a consistent message for their team, it can work out better than it might have otherwise.
And what was the, do you think, the root cause of this leader's reluctance to be the face of the communication, if you could guess?
Well, it was a difficult message to deliver. He did not agree with the change. He was being told by the CEO, this is what we're doing. He did not agree with it. He did not back it. And his personal fiefdom was being reduced. So his span of control was less than it would be otherwise. And, you know, he was feeling loss. And his reaction to that was to dig in his heels and say, this is not going to go forward. So I was in a position, unfortunately, to have some conversations in which the message was, this is going forward sort of with or without you. Tough conversations to have.
How do you give feedback to a leader when she or he is off script and most likely will do the same thing the next time they stand up or communicate?
Phil, because I was certain that this particular leader would go off script, I planned for each of the meetings to have an HR person in the room because, you know, there could be repercussions. So first of all, I had the HR person in the room. Second of all, I would always have a debrief right after the meeting to say, so how do you think that went? Are there areas that we might be able to do better in? And when tensions are high, it can be difficult for that person to see that their responses might have been less aggressive. So you need to have constant communication. There's the debrief, and then there's, you know, a day later, another debrief, because in hindsight, we're going out again in 2 days, we'll be on the stage again. How might we avoid that situation? So it's really constant communication with that person and helping them to see that they are important to the audience. The audience trusts what they have to say. And you need that message to be consistent between groups, because do employees speak to each other offline? Oh, let's talk about that. So we need to make sure that each time we're speaking or sending an email or having a conversation, that it is absolutely the same message, not the same words, but that we're expressing the goal of the change in the same way.
Are there recommendations for the listeners of how do you deliver communication for non-communicators to the leadership team or even, supervisor, manager level so that they have sort of a base level or a foundation of good communication skills?
My approach, Phil, is to take a look at what the messaging is, what the timing is, who are the audiences, and how do we want to structure it? And I actually, with the help of the team, put together communication packages for each level so that people have a script. And you can't just send the script out to them and say, here you go, deliver it. And this is time consuming. And this is why a lot of folks say, oh no, we're not doing that. You need to have a conversation with each group, each level group. Is it the senior sponsor? You're in communication probably on a daily basis with that person. Then you have the middle managers, which can always, that can be the black hole of communication because the senior leader says to his or her next line down, communicate this to everybody. Well, some do and some don't. You need to make sure that it's being done. So you also need to have that package for the supervisory level, which is who people go to. I just heard a message, Mr. or Ms. Supervisor, about this change that's happening. What do you know about it? The worst thing that can happen is for that supervisor to say, I never heard of it. Oh boy. So we need to make sure that everybody's prepared to answer the questions that will probably come up. And that's the communication team's job to say, okay, what are people likely to ask? Am I losing my job? The first thing people want to know. If I'm not losing my job, do I have to train somebody else to do parts of my job? What's the new way I'm going to work? So it's ways of working that have to be addressed. And the supervisor is the one that people go to for that.
Very interesting. And I was working on a rescue last year, and the communication approach was at the top level, as you had mentioned, and that was it. So, a real life situation, even at the director level, where this one director said, well, I wasn't briefed on this. And then the next time, well, I was briefed on it 10 minutes before. And what I gleaned from that is not only does it just send the wrong message and misalignment and just poor project management communication. But from that person's perspective, he didn't feel important. And you could tell it, like he had an emotional response, like, yeah, I'm not important enough to have been briefed. So I'm going to give you my own view, which was a negative view. Have you seen that before?
Absolutely. Involvement in either the planning phase or the next phase of a project, people need to feel included. They want to be accessed for their information. They want to be asked about their opinion. And that's a great time to be able to say, well, yeah, we thought about that, and maybe this is why we are using that approach or we're not using that approach. Thank you for your input. It helps people get behind the project because we're talking about making changes to human beings' lives, and everybody has feelings and emotions. Not acknowledging that we're dealing with people is usually the biggest point of failure.
Given that, people bring their whole self to work, we're all emotional beings, how do you effectively communicate bad news? And your example of, there'll be downsizings or we're cutting budgets or, we're going to have to move and relocate, whatever it is, initially it's not seen as a positive, but it's clearly a takeaway. How do you do that well?
That is usually the most difficult thing, Phil. And what is the assessment of doing it well? What's the measurement? Do we get people to understand the reason for the change? Or are we looking for people to be happy about the change? In my view, change management is not about making people happy. It's about helping people understand why we need to change, what we're going to do, what the roadmap looks like, and helping people understand that they have the choice to make as to whether or not they are going to embrace the change, accept the change, or reject the change. And I think we have to approach it as though we're dealing with adults, keeping an eye on the fact that emotions can run high. I think we need to help people understand the change first. And that means usually including the business case for the change. Why are we doing this? What is the reason that we're making this change? If it's to maintain viability of the company, people can usually understand that. If it's to cut costs, we need to say that. And we need to say it in a way that is forthright. People understand there's a budget. They have a budget, hopefully, at home, and that things need to change sometimes in order to stay within that. And how do we help them understand that in order to prosper, we may need to be a little bit more constrictive now? And I've always been a big proponent, and it's not widely accepted, but I think it's a corporation's obligation to help people understand that they have control over their career. And corporately, it would be great if there was a plan to help people understand that they need to build their skills so they can use them either here or elsewhere.
It's a great point. And, you know, going back where you said, you know, change management isn't about making people feel happy, which I absolutely agree. What I found with the most successful changes that have been communicated very well is that it does make them feel respected. So even within a 15% reduction in staff, and, you know, by working through this next year, whether you're with the Go Forward team or you move on, we'll build your skills, which I think is so rare that I see, so that you can move them. You know, we'll take care of you as much as we can to manage the transition, because with dignity and respect, I think, is the default. And if you do it well, even though you're not happy that you're leaving, that perhaps you can still get a comment that I was dealt with professionally and as supportively as possible. And that's the best state that you could ever have when someone's leaving and they don't want to go.
Yes, I totally agree.
And then I wonder for, you know, the types of messages, because you're saying, you know, treat people like adults, which is so important. It's a foundation, isn't it? Where there's one example of not doing so is not being transparent and, you know, hedging the questions. How do you treat people like adults just as principles with what you have to communicate?
I believe that being honest about the reason for the change up front is one of the best ways to start the conversation. We're making this change to the organization because, and you fill in the blank, but for example, because we are losing market share by 80% because we haven't done X, Y, and Z. If we continue on the path that we're on, we will be out of business in 6 months. No one will have a job. If we make some of these changes, we will be able to retain 60% of the workforce. These are the changes that we have in mind, and we would like your feedback on them for going forward. Be upfront. Tell people why we're doing this. Skirting the issue, people see through that immediately. And they become resentful. You're treating me as though I'm a child. You are not telling me the truth, and you're asking me to give you something, my loyalty, my hours, my, you know, whatever, and I can't trust you. Why would I follow you?
But being consistent, I would imagine, becomes easier because this is, we have lost 80% market share. We do have to do these changes. It's repeating the message versus creating anything new.
It is. And the consistency is the next part, because I will tell, this is anecdotal. There was in an extremely large corporation, we created the messaging for an enormous enormous downsizing. It was going to be, you know, 20,000 people globally. It was delivered by the CEO in an all-hands meeting, televised all over. We're going to be downsizing 20,000. After that meeting, Phil, people came up to me and said, do you think that maybe some people are going to lose jobs? Huh. And I thought, well, we said it out loud. We gave a number. What do we do next? And I realized what we do next is you can't have that shifting baseline syndrome going on. You have to come back and say, in the meeting we had 2 days ago, the message was that there will be a downsizing of 20,000 people globally. Keep delivering the message, because when people hear shocking things, many times they go deaf. They don't hear it really. It's too overwhelming. So you need to keep restating the same thing. Some people say it takes 7 times hearing the message before it actually sinks in. So you must, you can't just throw it out there, drop the bomb, and walk away. You need to have a consistent plan to continue that messaging. And each time you can add on to it. We said this, and now we're going to share with you the next phase of how we're going to do this. And then the next time you build on it, but you keep reiterating and making sure that at each level of the organization, that message is the same.
The kind of the spirit of the podcast is typically there's not a lot of time to move forward. You know, we come in, you know, short deadlines. If you came in and did sort of, if there's one thing you could do to ensure communication is effective that would give you the 80-20 result, given there wasn't a lot of time, what would that be for you?
Through experience, I would say it is to garner the trust and support of the senior sponsor for the change and ensure that that person will work with you to deliver consistent messaging throughout the project. And that does mean working very closely with that person and creating the relationship that will allow that messaging to go forward, allow that person to say, yes, I'm on board. I will deliver the messaging. I will make sure that my people deliver the message, and I will follow up with that.
Such a great answer. And because without that support from the leader, we've talked, you know, just things go astray. And one thing I would do is you mentioned the roadmap of how to go forward. And what I've seen in the past is people really don't know the steps that will take them from where they are now to where they need to go and what activities, the timing. Well, when are we going to go next? When, you know, what's happening now? They tend to flounder. It would allow me to celebrate making progress, because I think if people see progress, then they know they're actually moving toward something in a good way. I think your comment about if you don't have the leaders supporting you, regardless of how good the plan is, people will still be lost. And just as we close off right now, I was wondering, Linda, could you share with the listeners sort of a final tip or a watch out or an insight or a thing to remember about effective communication during change that would help them in their own changes?
It would be to continue listening to what people are saying about the change. What's happening, not in the formal meeting, but what's happening sort of at the water cooler or in the chat on the Zoom meeting? What are people feeling and thinking that might not be part of the planned meeting? It's the side conversation that gives you excellent insight into what you might need to do next or how you might need to pivot and change in your approach.
What great advice, because that's really the truth of how people are feeling is what they're talking about to their friends. Thank you, Linda. Thanks so much for being on the Change on the Run podcast. Thanks for sharing your perspectives. How can people get in touch with you?
Oh, well, they can take a look at my website, which is Strategic Change Associates. And they can also take a look at me on LinkedIn.
Fantastic. Thank you very much. Excellent. And I'd also like to thank our producer, Charlie Buckley, and thanks to you for listening. If you have any questions or comments, please email me at phil@changewithconfidence.com. And for upcoming episodes, please subscribe to the Change on the Run podcast, which is available on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, and Spotify. And please write a review if you have the time. And until the next time, I wish you all the best as you continue to lead change.